So glad that you're here. Everyone that's joining us online, so glad that you're with us as well. Thanks for carving out this time so that we could be together. Hey, I would be remiss. It does not go beyond my recognition that we are going to be talking about generosity today during a weekend, Memorial Day weekend, where people have in the past laid down their very lives to allow us to enjoy the freedoms that we enjoy here as a country. And so I hope that in addition to all of the Memorial Day festivities and traditions that you may have, whether it's barbecuing or weather permitting, boating, or whatever it is you do, that I hope that you will take some time, you'll carve out some time, and you will reflect on the meaning of Memorial Day, and that this is a time for us as a nation to reflect on those who have paid the ultimate price. They have lived incredibly generous by laying down their very lives to protect those freedoms that we have and we enjoy in our country. And so I want to just make sure that I make that statement before I get into what I want to say today. You know, we have been blessed to be a blessing, and you've heard me say that a lot. But I think sometimes we underestimate even the little ways that we can be a blessing to people. I was reading this last week about a guy, his name's Tim, businessman in Oklahoma City, very successful guy, but he was also a follower of Jesus, and so he recognized that his success, really, the blessings that he had in his life, really had come to him from the Lord. And one morning he woke up and he just had this impression that he was going to help somebody that day. He didn't know what that would look like, how that would play out, but he just had this overwhelming sense that today was a day he was going to help somebody. And so he went into his day with a heightened sensitivity, just kind of his eyes open to, you know, what was going on around him. But he went through his day at work and nothing out of the ordinary happened. And it was on his drive home that he saw a car pulled off to the side of the road, flashers on, and he thought to himself, well, maybe this is my opportunity. Maybe this is the chance for me to help somebody. So he pulled over and he met Jerry. Jerry had a flat tire. Ironically, that very morning, Jerry gave his one and only spare tire to a friend of his who was in desperate need of a tire, and so he gave him his spare. So now, here Jerry is on the side of the road, flat tire, no spare. So Tim says to Jerry, hey, listen, I can get you to the tire store, get you to, you know, it's to where you can buy a new tire. And so he hops in with Tim, and they are on their way. Well, as they're on their way, Jerry begins to unpack a little bit more of his story. Tim learns that Jerry had moved to Oklahoma City to get a fresh start. He really needed a new beginning. And when he got to town, he knew no one. He had no job. In fact, the first 2 months of his time in Oklahoma City, he lived out of his van. He finally pieced together enough small jobs and revenue stream to be able to get into an apartment. In fact, he still had multiple jobs, and he was on his way to his apartment when he got a flat tire so he could change clothes to get to another job. And so when that information came out, Tim says, well, why don't we do this? Why don't I get you to your apartment? You can go in, change your clothes. I'll get on the phone, call a tow truck. We'll get your car to the tire store. I'll get you to work so you don't lose any time with work. And so he says, okay. So he takes him to the apartment. He comes back out of his apartment, fresh change of clothes. And Tim says to Jerry, now, Jerry, if you could just do anything, I mean, if you could work at any job you wanted to work at, what kind of job would you want to do? And Jerry said, well, you know, I've always thought I'd be a great salesman, but I've just never really had the opportunity. The very next morning, Tim had a fishing trip planned with Bill. Bill begins to hear about this encounter that Tim has with Jerry. Bill happens to be the owner of one of the largest Chevrolet dealerships in town. Bill asked Tim, "Do you think Jerry would make a good salesman? I mean, could he sell cars?" Reflecting on the conversation, Tim says, "You know what? I think he could." A few days later, Bill interviews Jerry, hires him on the spot. Today, Jerry is the number two salesman in that dealership. He's living a very comfortable life, and he's driving a much more reliable car. Now, here's what's interesting about that story. Had of Jerry not been kind and gave his spare tire to a friend in need, had Tim not been willing to inconvenience himself to pull over on the side of the road to help Jerry in his time of need, there would have never been an interview with Bill that actually became a life-altering opportunity. Can you see the ripple effect of a simple act of kindness? You guys, I think sometimes we underestimate. I think most of the time we underestimate. We sell ourselves short in terms of the kind of difference we can make in someone else's life. Because we just think, well, what can I do? Well, you could pull over and help somebody, right? You could wake up in the morning with this idea that I'm going to live my day today with a heightened sense of sensitivity. I'm going to be aware of not only my own concerns, I'm actually going to be aware of what's going on around me. I'm going to posture myself to hear the whisper of the Holy Spirit. And I'm going to be willing to take courageous steps when it becomes obvious that there's a need that I might be able to meet. I think that as followers of Jesus, we have opportunities every day to make a difference in people's lives. That's the reason why Jesus said that you're going to be like a city on a hill. Remember what he said in Matthew chapter 5? Look at what he said, Matthew 5:14. You are the light of the world, like a city on a hilltop that cannot be hidden. No one lights a lamp and then puts it under a basket. Instead, a lamp is placed on a stand where it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, now look at this, in the same way, let your good deeds shine out for all to see, so that everyone will praise your heavenly Father. Interesting. It's your good deeds that shine out. It's interesting that Jesus equates good deeds to light. That it's your good deeds that can actually pierce the darkness of a sin-ravaged world. Your good deeds. It's not when you get up in someone's face and tell them all the things they're doing wrong. It's your good deeds. It's your good deeds that shine out. And so that everyone will see your good deeds and then give thanks and praise to your Father in heaven. I find it interesting that good deeds become such a light in a dark world because goodness is one of the primary character traits of Jesus. It's really important for us to understand that. Goodness is one of the primary character traits of Jesus. Jesus went around doing good deeds all the time. In fact, look what it says here in Matthew 15:29. Jesus returned to the Sea of Galilee and climbed a hill and sat down. A vast crowd brought to him people who were lame and blind and crippled, those who couldn't speak, and many others. They laid them before Jesus, and he healed them all. The crowd was amazed. Those who hadn't been able to speak were talking. The crippled were made well. The lame were walking. The blind could see again. And they praised the God of Israel. Isn't that interesting? That it would say they praised the God of Israel. What that suggests is that there were other gods represented there that day, right? There were other gods that were represented in the community. There were other gods that probably even some of these people had turned to for help. But in that moment, they praised the God of Israel for what Jesus had done that day. That tells me that there are people who don't even serve God, people that aren't even in relationship with God. They don't share the same faith that you and I have. That when you and I engage in good deeds and we express God's love in tangible ways, there are people that are not even in relationship with God that will thank God for you because God brought them into their life at just the right time and you met a very specific need in their life. Now, we have been blessed to be a blessing. So as we kind of get through this morning, I want to make sure that we understand why. Why is it that we're to be a blessing to other people? Why should we live generous lives? Well, here's number one, because God is generous to us. God is generous to us. Look what it says in John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave. God so loved the world that he gave. And what did he give? His only begotten son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. That's one of the most famous verses of scripture known by people who don't even attend church, but they know that God so loved the world that he gave. Giving, generosity, is one of those indicators that we're actually loving people. But God not only loved us so much to take care of our spiritual needs, he also is generous to meet all of our needs. Look what it says here in 2 Corinthians 9:8. For God will generously provide all you need. Then you will always have everything you need and plenty left over to share with others. God wants to make sure that all of our needs are met, and he's going to generously provide for all of our needs, and then we will even have some left over to share with others. This is another reason why we're to live generous lives. Number two is because God expects us to share with others. There's an expectation that God has that he's not only going to meet our needs, but then he's going to overflow to where we have left over so that we can then in turn bless other people. Again, look what it says, 2 Corinthians 9:8-9. And God will generously provide all you need, then you will always have everything you need and plenty left over to share with others. As the scriptures say, they share freely and give generously to the poor. Their good deeds will be remembered forever. Wouldn't that be awesome? Wouldn't that be just such a great reputation to have? That the good deeds, the good that you engage in, like when you walk out of the doors of this place and you go out in the community and you live with a heightened sense of awareness of the needs all around you, wouldn't it be such a great reputation that someone would remember the good deed that you did for them, and that would be something that would stick with them forever? That they would never forget that moment where this total stranger came out of nowhere and you actually became the answer to someone's prayer? I just happen to believe that God's orchestrating this stuff all the time. And if you and I would be sensitive to the whisper of the Holy Spirit, there are needs all around us. That if we could somehow get our attention off of ourselves and onto the people around us, if we could begin to live other-centered lives, then we would become aware of these opportunities. And then people would be telling that story. Just think about this. A total stranger came up to me in my moment of need. I had just prayed this Hail Mary prayer. I didn't know what was going to happen. And then this person came up out of nowhere and met my need. That story is going to be retold over and over and over and remembered forever. We have the opportunity to make a real difference in people's lives. God did not create us to be containers of his blessings. He created us to be a conduit through which his blessings will flow to the people all around us. And when we identify a need and we meet it, chances are it's going to cost us something, right? It's going to cost us. And I think the immediate thing, you know, when we talk about living generously, the immediate thing, our default mode, is to go to think of money. Listen, for a lot of people, their time is way more valuable to them than their money. I mean, you think about it. You think about it. We would rather throw money at something to be able to just say we did something. We would rather give than participate and give up our valuable time, right? Listen, there are a lot of different ways to live generous lives. Resource, money, is just one resource that God has entrusted to you. But your time, your energy, your willingness to roll up your sleeves, to get in the game, to come alongside, to walk with, yeah, those are really amazing moments. And really God orchestrated kind of moments where someone walks away from that and says, God knew exactly what I needed and he brought you into my life. And that's the reason why I think there will be people who don't even have right now a relationship with God that will thank God for you when you live that kind of a life. It's the sacrifice of time, energy, and money. When it costs us something, it becomes really a great and sweet sacrifice to the Lord. In fact, look what it says here in Hebrews 13:16. And don't forget to do good and to share with those in need. These are the sacrifices that please God. It's really important that we understand that these are the kinds of sacrifices, this is the worship that God receives when we live these lives of good deeds and we're willing to live generously and share with others. The third reason is generosity multiplies God's blessing. Generosity multiplies God's blessing. In other words, we're not only conduits through which God's blessing will flow to other people. So it's not just the people that are blessed, but God then winds up blessing us for having blessed people. There is this counterintuitive principle where we think that we will have more if we hang on to what we have. There's a counterintuitive principle that says no. When you're willing to cast your bread on the water, it comes back to you. You need to understand. In fact, it's kind of funny. I was Roxanne and I went into Spokane yesterday and went saw my parents and took my mom and dad out for lunch. And she said, "Now, are you talking tomorrow?" And I said, "I am." "And what are you talking about?" And so I told her, and she said, "You know, we have learned you cannot outgive God. We've learned. And we have received blessing after blessing." And you know, I think back on my childhood and I think about how open-handed my parents lived with everything they had. Anything they had, you had access to, anything. And even their home, there were seasons where we had total strangers living with us in our home. They were just open-handed with the blessings that God had poured into their life. They were willing to pour into others. And now here they are in their old age saying, "You cannot outgive God." Look what Jesus says in Luke 6:38. "Give and you will receive. Your gift will return to you in full, pressed down, shaken together to make room for more, running over and poured into your lap. The amount you give will determine the amount you get back." Again, there's this counterintuitive principle. And Jesus is saying, listen, you can trust me with your resources, with your money, with your time, with your energy. You cannot outgive what I'm willing to pour into your life. How many remember what happened back in 2008? Anybody remember the Great Recession? Anybody remember? Yeah. There were people that lost everything. There was retirements that were lost. There were homes that were lost. There were people that moved out of our community to go elsewhere to find employment and to start over again. By the way, it was April 2008 that we finished this project of this building and assumed a huge new mortgage payment. Right in the midst of one of the most difficult financial seasons our nation had navigated in recent memory. And I remember sitting with our board at the time, having assumed this huge mortgage payment. Our worst case scenario was that if nothing changed, if finances did not pick up, if we just stayed the same and we didn't increase our revenue stream to offset the expense of this new mortgage, our cash reserves would be done in 9 months. We would blow through the cushion that we had set aside to be able to underwrite a season of deficit. We would blow through that in 9 months. And I said to our board, it's our natural tendency, it would be our natural tendency to hang on to what we have and to hoard. Because we see the financial climate, we see what's going on, we're losing people, they're moving out of the area. It would be our natural tendency to hang on to hoard. But let me tell you something. There is a counterintuitive principle in Scripture, and we cannot outgive God. And during a time when we could have, like, used a one-day offering, those of you who have been around here for a while know what that is. We give people an opportunity to bring what they have in one day, and all of that, 100% of that, goes out the four walls to help hurting people. And so at a time when we could have used a one-day offering, we're still going to provide people with an opportunity to bring a one-day offering, and we're going to give it all away. And it's counterintuitive, but I believe we're going to give our way through this financial crisis. And let me tell you something. In 20 years, we've only missed our projected revenue stream budget by $1,000 one time. One time in 20 years. Yeah, that is just a testimony of God's faithfulness, that he will stay true. When he finds conduit, when he finds people that understand that they're conduit, not containers, when he finds people that are willing to hold everything that he blesses them with an open hand, when he finds people like that, he just keeps pouring. He just keeps pouring because he's got people he's trying to reach all around you in the community. And when he knows that you're a person who's willing to invest time, talent, treasure, that you're willing to pour that out into the community, well, he's just going to keep blessing you. And so we want to be people who practice generosity. And so we're going to do that right now. We're going to practice some generosity. In fact, we've invited 5 organizations to be with us today, and I'm going to invite them up onto the platform right now. In fact, I'd like Rhonda Encinas, if you would come up. Rhonda represents, she's the founder and executive director of Priest River Ministries. Come right over here, Rhonda. And Kayla Hall and Two Feathers Smith, they represent Heritage Health Homeless Organization, or Outreach. They're going to come up and join us up here. Bill Muck is the executive director for On-Site for Seniors, the Bennett House. Come on up. Also, Jackson Latterman is the executive director for Juvenile Justice Outreach. And then Johann Schmitz, lieutenant with the Coeur d'Alene Police Department. He's a board member for the Coeur d'Alene Police Foundation. Would you join with me in welcoming all of these folks to our fellowship today? Come on over this way. So Rhonda, give us just a brief description of Priest River Ministries and what it is that you do to help people.
Well, first of all, good morning. Well,
I'm going to turn, it would help if I turn that on.
Okay. Can you hear me now? Good. Good morning, Lake City Church family. I am really honored to be here and on behalf of Priest River Ministries, Advocates for Women. In James 1:27, it says that undefiled and pure religion is to help women and children in their distress, and that's what Priest River Ministries does. We're domestic violence, sexual violence, trafficking, and stalking organization, faith-based, that helps bring hope to women and children who are suffering from violent homes. And we do that by providing many services for them, including shelter, but we also want you to know that we appreciate Lake City has been supporting us for a long time. We know you guys saturate us with prayer, and that's what keeps us going. And you volunteer for us, and you are there for us when we need you. And we just want you to know that we are incredibly grateful and that we see you. Thank you.
That's great. That's great. Who's speaking? Are you speaking, Two Feathers?
I think so.
Okay.
So our primary position in the community is to bring medical attention to the homeless. This church has been a supporter of us for over 5 years. Last year, you did a sleeping bag drive for us, and there was one person in your congregation who wanted to remain anonymous, but he donated 100 sleeping bags.
Wow.
And every one of them were used this year.
Wow. That's great. That's awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah, thank you for what you do. Let's go ahead and slide on down this way so that we can bring everyone else down center. Bill, tell us a little bit about what you do.
Good morning. My name is Bill Muck. I'm the executive director with OnSite for Seniors. And I love the story he started out with this morning about the flat tires. But Pastor, I think you missed the point of the story. Because had those guys not gone fishing, there would have been no help. So I think the point of the story was do more fishing. OnSite for Seniors is a faith-based ministry. It's a nonprofit that ministers to our senior citizens in their last years. So we do that through a couple of ways. We also take care of caregivers, because being a caregiver is a very, very difficult position. I lost my mother to Alzheimer's, and I know that in the last 2 years, she needed someone all the time. The problem is I had a job, and I had a family, and I couldn't be there for her. So what OnSite for Seniors does is we provide a place that they can bring their loved one. We have a doctor and two nurses on staff to take care of them during the day. We keep them active, engaged, playing games, while the caregiver gets to go out and do their life, go to their job, or be with their family. So it's a wonderful opportunity. We also do in-home medical care for seniors that can't get out. We get the chance to minister to people in their last days, weeks, and months of life. And some of them are strong Christian. Some of them have never heard the gospel before. So we get to talk with them about who Jesus is and what's going to happen on that day when they meet him. And so it's a wonderful opportunity. Thank you for supporting us. We love our seniors, and we love your support. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much. Jackson, tell us a little bit.
Yeah, thank you for the opportunity. So Juvenile Justice Outreach works side by side with the juvenile justice system here in Kootenai County. We run the chaplain programming at the Juvenile Detention Center, where we get to share the gospel with the kids that are incarcerated a few times a week. We also provide scholarships for juvenile probation programs like Equine Therapy, First Tee, Idaho Youth Challenge Academy. These are expensive programs, and these kids would not be able to participate if it weren't for the generous support of our community. We also provide gas cards, groceries, toiletries, and everything in between for the physical needs. We even pay for counseling, treatment, and we've got a kid in martial arts right now, actually, as well. So our goal is to support and encourage, introduce these kids and their families to Jesus, and take care of them in any way that they need.
That's awesome.
Yeah, thank you.
That's awesome. Thank you for what you do. Johan, last but not least.
Thanks. I'd rather respond to a bar fight or something than be up here in front of you guys, but thanks for having me. So the Coeur d'Alene Police Foundation, we have two primary goals. The first and foremost is to take care of the mental and physical well-being of first responders in our area. As you can imagine, outside of the inherent dangers of the job that we experience, we see a lot of really horrific things on a daily basis. And doing that over and over again, day after day, year after year, can leave a mark on your soul. And so we're just people, like the rest of you, working in the community, and sometimes we need help, and we are really bad at asking for help as cops and firefighters and first responders. We just want to hold it all inside. So our primary focus is to remove all the impediments that exist between getting first responders the help they need to be good dads, husbands, fathers, and community members. And that's primarily what we enjoy doing. Secondarily, we love kids, and so we are involved in a few kids programs in towns. You may have heard of some of them, Holidays and Heroes, where we shop with kids on Christmas and their families, the Toy Drive for the Children's Hospital here and in Spokane, and things like the Police Activities League. So we can't do any of it without support from the church and great people in our community. We're 100% donation-driven, so thank you for helping us help ourselves and help you guys.
That's awesome. Thank you, all of you. For what you do in our community, and we, as I said, every year, conduct what we call a one-day offering. And oftentimes, you all give in this offering, and you trust us to distribute this resource to organizations that are really doing a great job in helping people, but you don't normally get in on the moment where we actually pass this resource on to these worthy causes, but today you get to get in on it. And so I just want to say that this congregation loves you, loves what you do. Thank you for the contribution that you're making in the lives of people. We know that our community is a much better place because of your efforts. So don't grow weary in doing good. We do have some resource that we'd like to pass on to you. This is out of our one-day funds. And so I have a check for each one of you in the amount of $3,000 to say thank you so much for what you do. And we're so grateful for the way you're investing your lives. So thank you. God bless you guys.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.